In the previous video, we left off as Mike, an agency executive, asked how he should begin the process of a cost analysis. In this video, we'll learn how to take the first step towards doing a cost analysis. Ready when you are, Mike.
Great. Help me think about the data we need to gather about our in-home services to complete a good cost analysis.
A good cost analysis relies on information about a program's activities and considers the value of all resources used when implementing a service. Let's go through all the ingredients required to run your in-home service.
There's staff time, travel, training, facilities, supplies, contracted services.
That's a great start. An ingredient like travel could be broken down further into the cost of the car to the agency, gas, time spent traveling, and the cost of travel vouchers for participants, if you provide those. In addition, when you say staff time, it is important to recognize that staff spends time doing many different tasks throughout the day. For example, they do assessments, spend time with clients, write notes, and attend meetings.
That's really helpful. What's a good way to gather information that isn't included in budget reports, like time spent traveling or time doing assessments for the in-home program?
You can interview staff or create surveys to gather as much data as possible about the time staff spend doing various activities. These interviews or surveys can help you figure out how much time staff spend doing the different activities you've identified. Ideally, this type of information should be gathered in real time. This means having staff regularly record how they spend their time during a specific time period. While this method may be more of a burden for staff, it allows you to gather detailed data about how they spend their time. You could also gather this information retrospectively by asking staff how they spend their time over the past week or month. This method is slightly less burdensome, but generally results in a less accurate time estimate.
That makes sense. Now I've listed every resource my program uses and calculated the time spent on various program components. What's the next step?
Next, we need to determine the cost of these ingredients over a specific period of time. For this example, give me all of the direct costs for program staff of in-home services over a year.
Let's see. We have 5 case managers with a salary of $45,000 plus fringe, which is $11,250 each, and a supervisor salary of $60,000 plus fringe, which is $15,000, and travel expenditures of $5,000.
Perfect. Being able to assign a dollar amount is really important. You can then take it a step further by using this information gathered on the time staff spend on certain activities and use it to break down the numbers you just gave me. For example, if you have one caseworker that reported they spent 10 hours a week in the car, 5 hours a week doing intake assessments, and 10 hours a week writing notes, and 15 hours a week seeing clients, it's easy to figure out how much of their salary goes towards each of those activities.
Okay, so if I know the number of hours of each of my staff spend seeing clients and their salaries, I can assign a dollar amount for time spent seeing clients for the entire program.
Exactly. Now, don't forget, we need to take into account all other costs that may not seem like they're related to direct program costs, but are still part of the programmatic cost assessment. Do you have those numbers available?
Sure. Materials and supplies are $1,500. The depreciation costs of durable equipment is $1,250. The annual lease payment is $3,000. The utilities are $1,500. And personnel, whose costs are not directly attributed to the program, total $168,750 for salary and fringe.
Now remember, when doing a cost analysis, you need to take into account the cost of both volunteer and participant time. These families and individuals contribute resources. For example, the time spent in program activities and any out-of-pocket costs for transportation. A complete estimate of program costs would account for the value of these resources, since they could be used in other ways. To assess the cost of volunteer and/or participant time and resources, you may need to collect time estimates directly from the participants and volunteers, and then calculate the cost of time, travel, and other resources based on comparable wages, local travel transportation costs, and comparable market costs. And now, after adding up all of the costs of each individual resource, we can estimate total costs.
I see. So we account for each and every resource used by the program, and when put together, that number represents the cost of the program as a whole.
Correct. From here, you can calculate total program component costs, as we started to model a minute ago, or even cost per participant, depending upon how you obtained your cost estimates and what you include when you add up the numbers of each individual resource.
That makes sense. So my ability to calculate costs in certain ways depends on the data I have available and the data I collect.
Exactly. We've learned a lot about your program, Mike, and from here, if you conduct an outcome evaluation, you can take the next step and determine the cost effectiveness of these in-home services.
Thanks for helping me get started on this cost analysis, Phaedra. This should be very useful for my decision-making process.
Anytime, Mike. I hope you now have a basic understanding of the steps involved when conducting a cost analysis of a program in a child welfare setting. Thanks for joining us.